Well, actually, it was Saturday morning, about 4:30 in the morning.
So praise the Lord. Are you ready for the Word of God? Let's go ahead and dive into the Word of God. This is my favorite.
She was my like best friend for years and years.
You know when you go to that restaurant Chuck E. Cheese pizza place, and you know there's all those games that you can play? There's this one that has these colored balls, and this one area has yellow, blue, and all these different colors, and you jump in the balls and you can play in there with little kids. So right now, we're going to use that as our analogy, to we're going to go ahead and dive into the Word of God. But we also need to accept His Word as well. So, praise the Lord. My title, if you remember, last week I was ready with my title. Do any of you remember? And then last night, as I was getting ready to study that topic, I decided I wanted to put that on the back burner. Brother Candido says rats. But I wanted to put that on the back burner because I wanted to, I have another a point that I want to get across. I don't want to teach it just the surface. I want to get more in depth into teaching it. So my title for today is going to be, well, we're going to go ahead and get started with class. Oh, we're going to pray first. So we need to pray for offering today, because this is our once a month offering that we do at the beginning of the month. Lord, we pray that you will bless this offering for the deaf ministry. And I pray that you will touch Brother Nolan and anoint, give him anointing as he teaches the Word of God today. And help us to understand it in Jesus' name.
I actually have money today. I'm not a very good writer.
So, are you ready for what's next?
I'll try to.
So you think we're going to talk about this again? Jesus walking on the sea? But don't worry, I have a point that I'm getting across. There's the four gospel writers. There's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. These are four gospel writers. And they tell the story of they specifically tell about Jesus' life. So who wrote these books? All these writers wrote about Jesus walking on the sea. So which gospel? Was there one, two, or three gospels that talk about that? So Brother Casey thinks that Luke talked about it. I think they all did, didn't they? Didn't they all four of them talk about it with different perspectives, maybe? So Candido thinks that all the Gospels talk about Jesus walking on the sea. Casey thinks that it was just Luke that talked about it. So right now I'm going to go ahead and show you. It was actually Matthew, Mark, and John, the three gospel writers that actually wrote about it. This is the opposite of what you thought. Luke did not write about it. He's shocked about that. But a good try anyways. That was good. Hey, he's still learning. So, now you guys will remember this. So now if I ask this question again, who wrote about Jesus walking on the water? All of three of the gospel writers except for Luke. Very good. I like to use the projector because it helps people to grasp the concepts and hold on to them longer or better. He said that Bill Gates said that the best thing to do was to write about things and point to it as he's talking about them. And draw circles around what he's talking about, just so that you can visualize it as you're hearing it, and it actually sticks in your mind better. You're able to retain it better. So if I'm just signing this, with no visuals, it's not going to stick as much. And this applies to hearing as well, but if I have more visuals, people are able to retain it better and you enjoy it better. So if I ask you, which one's right about this? Who? Remember the three Gospels wrote about Jesus walking on the sea. There's Matthew, he wrote about Jesus walking on the sea. Mark wrote about Jesus walking on the sea, and John as well. Luke is the one that did not write about this story. I was studying this morning, and this is... If you want to really study the Word of God, this is awesome. But when you're just studying the Word of God, it's not you're not using this to get one up on other people.
Yeah,
it's for your own. You need to study it for your own benefit. You can inform people about what you've learned.
Good.
But it's not a debate. So Luke did not talk about Jesus walking on the sea. Nope. He did not talk about that at all. Only Matthew, Mark, and John wrote about it, but Luke did not write about this story. So the three, right, were they in the boat with Peter? Were Matthew, Mark, and John? Only John was in the
only
boat.
Only
Matthew and John were in the boat with Jesus.
Mark and Luke were not.
Oh, and by the way, most of the writing was John himself wrote about it, but Mark did Mark not write on his own?
My apologies.
I missed what he said. So here's your Bible. If you were to open up your Bible, how much you wrote about it? Yeah. So Casey asked me, were all of those people on the boat with Jesus? I mean, when he walked on the water. Matthew and John were there, but Mark and Luke were not on the boat. But they wrote themselves. And also Mark wrote how much percent from what he saw he wrote down.
Oh.
Which is the opposite of John, which is 92% of everything that was written he wrote himself. But the others got perspectives from other people. But John,
Mark and Luke are much more similar rather than John, whereas John is 92%
like
more original.
That's it, okay.
There's 92% more originality in John versus Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Okay. Who are much more similar in the writing. Maybe John has much more
earlier
personal
he said
perspective.
That Mark took most of his writings from other people, a high percentage.
Well, John is much more of a personal, original perspective. That's why his is much more original in writing.
Mm-hmm. Luke took all of his from other people's writings.
Okay.
That help?
Yes, it did. Okay, so what happened before Jesus walked on the sea? Do you remember what happened right before that? These are all these stories that have happened, but before Jesus walked on the sea, what was the story before that? Did the miracles that
the miracle that Jesus performed before he walked on the sea?
He fed the 5,000, that's why. There's a crowd. He wanted to get away from the crowd. This is when he fed the 5,000 people. Remember. And again, who wrote this? It was the only one who didn't write this.
No, he's asking.
Who
Who did and who didn't write about the miracle of the 5,000 being fed?
So which gospel wrote about the 5,000 feeding the 5,000?
Two of them did.
So what class is for them? Asking
was
who,
it all of them?
Who thinks? Candido thinks all of them.
Candido thinks all of them, maybe. Candido thinks
Casey
Matt,
only
or
says
Cassie
Mark.
Thinks Mark only wrote the story. Okay.
Anybody else want to throw?
So did you see their confusion? It's okay. This is all right. I want you, the more we read, the more you learn, mm-hmm. you understand. So if you get ready for your answer, all of them. Yay! But again, remember that these were following Jesus, and they saw what Jesus was doing. And these four, they didn't see everything. They didn't see everything. It's different perspectives of from what they've seen.
They didn't follow him.
They didn't follow him all, yeah, every day, 24/7. They couldn't. But some wrote about one perspective, and some, maybe somebody wasn't there during this one event that happened, but they wrote about all these different stories. So the story of the 5,000, when he fed the 5,000, in Matthew, he wrote the whole story about the feeding the 5,000. And I'm going to show you in the scripture, I'm going to show you what each one of these had to say about it, okay? So first we're going to focus on Matthew. And what it says here in Matthew chapter 14, verse 17, it says, and they, and this is like all the disciples, it means all the disciples. And they say unto him, so if you hold on a second, So you know the story, and you would jump ahead, but let's just go back and read this verse here. And they said unto him, which to him is Jesus, which means all the disciples together, we have here but five loaves, which is the bread, and two fish. So remember that. Matthew said, this is Matthew's writing. And this is what class is for. And then in Mark, chapter 6, verse 38, he also wrote about this. And he, which is Jesus, he said unto them, which is referring to the disciples, how many loaves have ye? Go and see. And when they knew, that means they came to him and they knew. Jesus already knew too, but they came and they said, we have five and two fishes. But if you notice here, he asks, how many loaves do you have? And so if you understand that, you would be able to put it together. When he just said five, he'd asked them how many loaves they had. So he said, we have five and two fishes. Mm-hmm. So are you ready for some more? Now in Luke chapter 9, verse 13. Okay. But he, which is Jesus, he said unto them, give ye them to eat. And they, which is the disciples, said, we have no more but just 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Except we should go and buy meat for all these people. They say for all this people. So I can go more in depth a little bit later. And then John, you ready to hear what John said? In John chapter 6, verse 9. So I'm going to go ahead and sign this verse. After he's done reading it, I'll sign it. The verse says, there is a lad here which have 5 barley loaves. And if you go back, it says, there is a lad here which has. So what does this word lad mean? It's a little boy. The word lad means a little boy. Just a little boy. And he said, this little boy here has. Again, the verse says, there is a lad here which hath 5 barley loaves, which is bread, and 2 small fishes. So now we know that the fish was small. So when he put down small, then it must have been small.
Well, it could have been in perspective too, because the small could be here if you had a big old, like a shark or something. You
know? Never know.
What they probably called a loaf is like a single bun.
Yeah.
Barley loaves.
So he had 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes. But the verse goes on to say, but what are they among so many? So why do you think that boy was here? Maybe the boy stood up. Maybe
that would be me.
Maybe he's one of the little boys. Very interesting. So now let's go ahead and focus on what John had to say. Okay. It's very interesting in what John, in John's perspective, and what he had to say. In John chapter 6, verse 5. If you can follow along with me, okay? So you can imagine a computer here in front of us, and I have my PowerPoint. As I'm typing it in, things get flipped.
What is it? Website, yes, BibleGateway.com.
Okay, yeah. So I open up my Bible, and I have a little mini library. It's really small, but I know some people have a lot of books. Some people collect a lot of books. But. So I pulled this one book out and I was doing some comparison. I was doing my studying. Oh, that's right. Okay. So I was reading carefully, word for word, because I wanted to make sure I understood everything. And as I was reading it, I noticed something. So I put it down. So I wanted to show it to you today. It says, when Jesus then lifted up. So that means he looked up. He lifted up his eyes and saw a great, this word here, this is a great not just a little bit, but it was, and when John was reading this, as he was writing this, you gotta remember, he saw a great, was this word here, company? Does this mean a business that was set up?
Company?
No, it actually refers to a great amount of people. It's just, great company means a lot of people. A lot of people come in to do business here. He saw a great company come unto me. So Jesus was here, and he saw all these people were coming towards him. There's a great company of people coming towards him. So from what I learned in their tradition, when a company of people comes, they usually have to give them food. When they have a meeting of sorts, when a bunch of people are together, they tend to give them some food. And that's their tradition at that time, what they did. And Jesus knew this. So when the great company of people came unto him, he saith unto Philip. So you got to imagine, all these people are coming. And maybe the boat was already there, but Jesus called unto Philip.
He said, Philip.
He called out to Philip and got his attention. And he said, whence? So when Jesus saw all these people coming, he told Philip, from whence shall we buy bread that these may eat? And he asked him that. So right here it says when he, which is referring to Jesus, saith unto Philip. So Jesus asked Philip, asked him directly, spoke directly to Philip, not to the other people. He spoke directly to Philip. And he asked him. He said, put your iPhone away. Pay attention. And Philip answered him, and he said, Philip, when shall we buy bread that these may eat? And this was a question he asked him. If you notice, it ends with a question mark. That means he asked him a question. So he was waiting for his response. Now Philip needs to respond to what Jesus asked, right? Does that make sense? And in verse 7, which got moved way over here, Philip answered him. So remember, Jesus asked him a question, and so Philip has to answer him. So you ask, what happened to verse 6? Because it goes from 5 to verse 7. So what happened in verse 6? I mean, the answer is proper. What happened in verse 6? So John, when he wrote verses 5, 6, and 7, I'm trying to stay out of that light so it's not shining on me. So here he asked Philip, where shall we get bread so that all these can eat? And then in verse 7, Philip answered him. Philip answered him. 200 penny worth of bread is not sufficient for all the, for them. So I want to explain this a little bit. This word 200 penny worth, I found 4 similar definitions provide the same idea. You know that in the Roman time, the money, Roman times, their money they used were, there were not coins. Or they used the Roman coins. Yeah, they used Roman coins. So there was, I read on the commentary that was for these books, I read several different commentaries, and I was able to get an idea of what they're talking about. 200 pennies worth. That means it was the value of working for about 6 months' wages. Another commentary said that it was a full year's wage. Another commentary said that it was about 8 months' worth. So it's just, suffice it to say, there was several months' pay, but he said even that would not be enough to feed this many people. There's like 5,000 people. Luke said it was 5,000 people.
Some people say, well, look, there's only 5,000 people, so I'll get to that later.
So if we go back to verse 6, then we'll get a better idea of what's going on. Yeah, good deal, wants to hurry up. I think we'll just hold on to this and come back in 2 weeks. by the way, actually, next week, on Sunday morning, we will be gone into Fremont. They invited me to go preach at their church on Sunday morning, so I will not be here. So just letting you know. After that is Father's Day, so... but then after Father's Day, we will go back to our schedule as planned. So verse 6. Is the color, can you read the color okay on your screen? Okay. I'm going to go ahead and sign the verse 6 as well. So. John wrote this. And Jesus asked him a question and in verse 5, and Philip answered him in verse 7. So I'm going to explain. This is in his own words. This is what John was there during his time. He was there when he saw this. And so he wrote from his memory what happened during this time. And verse 6 said, so Jesus asked him, when we would buy bread for these to eat. And this is like a test, he said. And this he said to prove him, that for he himself knew what he would do. He knew what he would do. He already had plans. He already knew that they would be able to break the bread and fish and feed everybody. So Jesus already knew. He already knew what he was going to do. So when Philip answered, is this clear? Do you understand? Yes, I know. And this is so perfect. When Jesus asked a question, and in verse 7 he answered him. But in verse 6, he inserted that Jesus already knew what he was going to do. So now, are you ready for verse 8? So in verse 7, Philip answered and said, 200 pennies worth of bread is not sufficient for them. That every one of them would take just a little. One of the disciples, Andrew, which is Simon Peter's brother, he saith unto him, which is, he's saying unto Jesus, he said, hey, verse 9, and he already knew there's four gospel writers that wrote about this, and they knew. And Andrew, he said, there is a lad here, a little boy, and he hath 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes. But what are they among so many? So here's an example of the 5 barley loaves, 5 loaves, and 2 small fishes. And that is not enough to feed 5,000 people. Well, wait a minute. Back to the 5,000 people.
I'll get to
that in a minute.
Yeah.
So they just had the 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes. But if you notice this picture of all these people here, there's just many people. Can you imagine the crowds of 5,000 people? And they were all looking toward Jesus. So Jesus had to provide food for them. It was their tradition. He had to provide food for all these people that came. And Andrew pointed out that there's just one boy who has just his 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And verse 10 says, and Jesus said, make the men sit down. Boy, could you imagine all these men sitting down at once? At the church here, can you imagine? We have about 1,000 people here at church, right? 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread is not nowhere near enough to feed all the people in our church, right? But can you imagine 5,000 people being there? Wow. So Jesus told them to make the men sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down. And if you notice, it says, in number, about 5,000. So if you look at the word 5,000, so let's see what the other 3 gospel writers have to say about this. He wrote about the feeding of the 5,000. So if you look at the other 3 writers, you will notice something that's very clear. In Matthew chapter 14, verse 21, he wrote about when Jesus fed the 5,000. He wrote about this as well. And he says, and they that had eaten were about 5,000 men beside women and children. So it wasn't just 5,000. There was possibly more like 15,000 people. 5,000 men, then you think that each of them have wives and children. Altogether, it's possibly could have been about 15,000 people to feed with just 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. 1 fish is not enough to even fill me up. 5 loaves of bread and 2 small fishes to feed all these people? Wow. So now we know that this 5,000 was actually more, significantly more than just 5,000 people. Verse 11 goes on to say, and Jesus took the loaves. Whatever size they were, they took the loaves, bread. And when he, and notice this, it says when he took the loaves and when he had given thanks, he distributed it to the disciples, which means John also got some to pass out. So, and they're all writing the story. They all were there. They distributed it to the disciples to pass out to the 5,000. I wonder how long it took to pass out all this food to all these people. Wow. Just 12 disciples passing out all this food to all these 5,000, 15,000 people. That's a lot of work. They've been passing food out for a long time. to them that were seated. And likewise, of the fishes, as much as they would. So he was passing out the fish and the bread. Could you imagine? You knew how much was in there, and you just keep taking from there to pass out more. And as you're passing it out to all these people, that was a miracle in itself, that food stretched. As they were giving out all this food to these people, it's like a buffet when they're going out to eat, an all-you-can-eat buffet. So they can eat all they want. Just keep piling it up. So can you imagine just passing out food to all these thousands of people? And you imagine there's people that say, oh, I want more. I imagine those disciples were kept very busy. When they were filled, when all those 5,000 people were satisfied and filled, and they could not eat no more. Bible says, when they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments. That means leftovers. Gather up the leftovers. So when all these people were eating, and they ate until they were stuffed. So are you guys ready for lunch this afternoon? I'm getting hungry talking about this food. So they said, gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost. So they gathered up everything that was left over. Everybody was full after they got done burping and making more food. They were all content and filled. Whatever was left, they gathered up. And the verse 13 says, therefore, they gathered them together and filled 12 baskets with fragments. So that means they filled. This verse right here, this is, which word are you looking for? Therefore they gathered them together and filled the 12 baskets. Okay, there's 12 baskets. They had 12 baskets that they filled up with everything that was left over. After they fed all those people, there were 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves, which remaineth over and above. So that means they had, after they had fed all those 5,000 people or more, they had 12 full basketfuls left. So this means the Holy Ghost is sufficient for all of you. It is enough. Here they are, gathering up all the leftovers, putting it all back together. This is fascinating. They passed out all this food, and then when it was done, they gathered it all back, and there was 12 baskets left. Jesus is awesome. We had food for days. And all that was just from the 5 loaves and 2 fish, small fishes. That is a lot of food left over from just 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And verse 14 goes on to say, I think I want to finish this right here. Said, then those men, when they had seen the miracles that Jesus did, they saw what Jesus had done, said, this is of a truth, that prophet that should come. Now they want Jesus to become the king, but Jesus, when Jesus left, and he went and walked on the sea after this event, and the 12 disciples were there when they saw Jesus, and that's the very next thing that happened right after this story. So Jesus escaped himself. Almost done. The prophet Elisha went to a widow woman. It was her husband had passed away. He went to this widow woman, and she had a son. And when he went to the house, the widow woman, she had just a tiny amount of oil left. And the prophet told her to feed him. And he told her to gather up all the vessels, as many as she could gather, to bring him there. So she brought in all the vessels. And with that little tiny amount of oil that she had, she filled all of those vessels that she had borrowed until they were full to the brim. From just that little small amount. That is a miracle. That's awesome. So my title for today is two small fishes and 5 loaves is enough.
That's a long title. What?
Say the title again, the full title again. The title is 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Oh, that was okay.
That feeds 5,000 people.
Yeah, I was going to add the pigs. Yeah.
Which possibly could be good. You know, 15,000 people, 12 baskets left over.
So remember, the water that was turned to wine was the first miracle that Jesus performed. And then you're talking about the Old Testament. This is the Lord told Joel, I will pour out upon all flesh, my spirit upon all flesh. And that was the prophet Joel that he told. So, okay. I am actually done. So, let's pray for close. Wow, that was good teaching. I never thought about that. That's awesome teaching. All of you benefit from his teaching. That was great. There's no limit to what God can do. Lord, we thank you for the story, what you've done. The miracles are awesome. And thank you, Lord, for this. In Jesus' name, amen.